good morning, good morning, and happy homecoming Sunday. It has been a phenomenal weekend of fun, fellowship, encouragement, celebration. I hope that you all have enjoyed this weekend as much as I have. Thank you so very much for your participation, for pressing your way after whatever was going on during the week, Friday, and you got here Friday night, pressing your way through the rain on Saturday. We had a building full of people yesterday for all the activities, and it has truly been a blessing. If you have enjoyed yourself, let me hear you say, yes, ma'am. Amen, amen, amen. Now, I want to take just a moment to acknowledge those who worked so hard to make this weekend happen for us, because I was truly blessed this weekend. It was only because of a lot of work that went into the preparation, the planning, setup, cleanup, breakdown. If you did any of those things, would you stand to your feet so that we can love on you for just a moment? Amen. Thank you so very, very, very much. Pastor Stephanie is not standing up, but I know that she was a part of that. We have a lot of folks who did a lot of work this weekend, and we appreciate all that you did. I had someone say to me over the course of the weekend, if it wasn't for what was going on this weekend, I'd be sitting at home by myself alone. But instead, I am in a room with my church family celebrating and having good fun. And so thank you for all your work to do that for us. So y'all, it's homecoming Sunday. It is our worship service, and today we are going to do just that. We are gonna worship God in song. We're gonna worship him in prayer. We're gonna worship him in our giving. We're gonna worship him by receiving the preached word, amen? And you're at home today, and so we want you to be comfortable in responding to all of those activities, whatever is comfortable for you. That may be raising your hands, that might be stomping your feet. If you would respond, talk back to the preacher, amen. You know how we do when we're watching TV and watching movies at home, when we're talking back to that television, talk back to the pastor and let him know whether or not he's preaching well. That really encourages him, as we found out on Tuesday night, right? Those of you who were in Bible study Tuesday night, amen. And so we want you to respond. You will also have an opportunity to respond to the preached word. If you want to make sure that you commit the word that you receive and apply it to your life, you're going to have an opportunity to come and do that through prayer at the end of service. You'll have an opportunity to make Word Tabernacle Church your home if it isn't already and you would like to do that. But most importantly, you are going to have an opportunity to accept an invitation to come into relationship with Christ. That is the most important decision we will ever make. And you are gonna have an opportunity to do that today if you have not already done so. That applies for you on East City as well. Thank you so much for being here with us this morning. And family, we have had so many people responding to that very invitation in recent weeks and months. So much so that in our 18-year history, we have always had baptism on first Sunday, amen? But in recent weeks, we've now added third Sunday. And so today is not only homecoming Sunday, it is baptism Sunday as well. And there are folks in the lobby ready to baptize four candidates for baptism this morning. And so at Word Tabernacle Church, we respond to the Great Commission that Jesus gives us in Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Amen. We are so grateful for the leadership's commitment to biblical teaching. And it's clear that Jesus here is teaching us to go make disciples and to baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And that's exactly what we're going to do today. Baptism is not salvation. And our candidates have gone through class and they understand that is the case. Baptism is only an outward expression of an inward work that has taken place. So baptism does not save us, it just shows that we are saved. We do it because we are saved, and we want the world to know of this wonderful relationship that we have in Christ. Amen? Amen? So let's celebrate with the four candidates this morning that are being baptized, and Pastor Galliard is in the lobby ready to start that service. Welcome to worship.
Hands, we can do a little bit. We need to make more noise in the lobby and sanctuary, East City campus. We are so excited today. So we've got our first candidate. Y'all celebrate Ivana Cooper. Ivana, have a seat right there, baby. Ivana, on the profession of your faith and obedience to the Great Commission, we now baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Come on over to your pastor, Jekiah. Come on over here. A little cool. Come on over here. Look up at the camera so everybody can see you. Y'all, this is Sister Jekiah. Can we celebrate her? Jekiah, have a seat right there. Jekiah, upon the profession of your faith and obedience to the Great Commission, we now baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. This is Sister Nyla. Come on over here, baby. Come on over here with me for a minute. Come here, Nyla. Look up at that camera right there. Y'all, this is Nyla Thomas Bullock. Come on, let's celebrate her. Nyla, have a seat right there on that bench. Nyla, upon the profession of your faith and obedience to the Great Commission, we now baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. This is our last candidate today. We're going to get ready to worship. Come on, I want the whole church standing up. Whole church standing up. You on East City campus, stand up. Y'all, this is Sister Sierra Harper. Come on, let's celebrate her. Hey, Sierra, have a seat right there. Sierra, upon the profession of your faith and obedience to the Great Commission, we now baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Come on, y'all, let's go back into the sanctuary. Let's get ready to worship.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Welcome to worship on East City in the house. We came to bless the Lord this morning. If you came to bless him, come on and put your hands together. Y'all. Listen, bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
God, you're worthy. Oh, you're worthy. Oh, God, he's worthy. He's worthy. Hallelujah. Can we just stay there for a second? Do I have anybody that knows that the Lord is worthy to be praised? From the rising of the sun until the setting of the same, the name of the Lord is worthy to be praised. I see hands lifted, but I need mouths to be open. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Come on, lift up your voice. We love you. We lift you. We adore you. Magnify you. Nobody like you. You're great. You're awesome. You're holy. You're mighty. You're great. We love you. Come on. We give you glory. Of the Lord is unsearchable. You can't find anybody like him. Do I have anybody that's a witness that I can't find nobody like Jesus? I've searched all over. I've looked high and I've looked low. I turned to my family and they didn't work. I turned to my friends and they didn't work. But when I called on the name of Jesus, he worked it out for me. Hallelujah. We bless your name. And he's God Almighty. He's a mighty God. He's a God that's above any other God. He's the God above all gods. He's the King above all kings. He's the Lord above all lords. I don't know about you, but that's worthy for me to loose myself and worship. Hallelujah. Come on, lift your hands all over this room. Now, if you have a relationship with the Lord for yourself, I want you to worship him in this moment. Who has he been to you? Who has he been to you? Has he been a healer? Has he been a redeemer? Has he been a savior? Come on, lift up your worship. Lift it up. God Almighty, Lord of glory, oh, we worship you. God Almighty, cut the music. You say, oh. Can you say it again and lift your hands? Oh, we surrender our lives to you. We surrender our hearts to you. Oh, we worship. We give you what is due your name. Oh, there's no one like you. Oh, we worship. Now, can you lift your hands and worship your God right here? Don't clap your hands. Lift up your voice. Lift up your voice to him. Has he been good to you? Did he save you? Did he make a way for you? Did he do something that nobody else can do? Can you lift up a worship that you don't give your spouse, that you don't give your kids? Lift it up. Lift it up. We worship you. We magnify you. You're worthy to be lifted. You're worthy to be adored. Worthy to be magnified.
Hallelujah. What a sweet, sweet spirit in this room. We're at the time of scripture and prayer. If you would, all that is not standing, would you please stand in honor of reading scripture this morning? We'll be coming from the 10th chapter of Hebrews. And we'll be reading the 23rd verse down through the 25th verse. And I'll be reading into your hearing from the New King James Version. If all hearts are prepared. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is faithful. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. If you would, get into your prayer posture. If that is stepping out into the aisle, it is. If that is kneeling, if that is coming to the altar, getting to your prayer posture, that we may pray to the God of our salvation. Eternal God, our Father, it's again, Lord, that we humble ourselves before you, and we're grateful for this day, God. Father, you're God, and beside you, there is none other, God. And Father, we're grateful that you are our creator. And us knowing that you are our creator, you create nothing without purpose, God. So in this sanctuary today, God, illuminate truth in our lives in such a way that we know exactly what our purpose is in you and exactly what our assignment is being a part of Word Tabernacle Church today, God. Father, lead us and guide us by your Spirit, God, that we will know and understand the finished work of Christ and the sacrifice that he made that allows us to go into the holies of holies, God. And Father, and we thank you, Lord, that in your presence, God, we know that we have salvation, God, through that confession that we are holding fast to, God. We know that we have healing, God, in you. And we know that we have deliverance in you, God. And we know, Lord God, that we have victory in you today, God. You did this, God, but you did it so that we can exemplify it in the earth today, God, as we continue to establish your kingdom, Lord. And Father, we thank you, Lord, that as you continue to stir in us, Lord, that you will awaken the unconditional love that you desire for us to have in the earth today, God. That we will see beyond each other's faults, Lord, and see the potential that all of us have today. As we present it, God, as we present our bodies holy and acceptable unto you, God, allow our good works to only be found in us acting out in your righteousness today, God. And Father, we gather today on this homecoming weekend, Lord. We gather in this sanctuary, and we gather on the East City campus in our living rooms, God, that we have turned into sanctuaries, God. That we may, Lord, gather, that we may be edified by your Spirit, Lord. That we may be strengthened, Lord. That we may help to carry one another's burdens today, God. Because the day draws nigh, Lord. It draws nearer and nearer with every given moment, every given day, every given month, every given year, Lord. So allow us to commune with each other. Allow us to fellowship with each other. Allow us to see the true spirit of the living God operating in us today, God, and every day after today, God. And Father, we thank you, Lord, that there have been songs that have gone up to Zion. We thank you, Lord, for every baptism candidate, Lord. We thank you for their lives. We thank you for their newness of life. Give them the strength to walk it out in power, God. Thank you for every ministry today, God. Thank you for the psalmists. Thank you, Lord, for the musicians, for the stronghold, for the greeters, God. Everyone that has collectively gathered to make this service all that you would have it to be, Lord. And we're grateful, God. But I would be remiss not to mention the man of God, our pastor, Pastor G, God. Dip him deep down into your storehouse of wisdom and knowledge, God. We know that he has prayed and we know that he has prepared, but as he stands flat-footed, Lord, allow the soil of our hearts to be prepared for the word that is about to come forth, Lord. That we will be made whole in you and that we will have clarity of mind of what you're calling us to and what you're calling us from. We give thanks, Lord, and we patiently wait with a great expectation of what you're going to do next in us as individuals and next in us as a church body. We thank you, Lord. We shout hallelujah to your name. We glorify your name this morning, God, for you and you alone are worthy. Let us all say amen, amen, and amen.
place. God, you are welcome in this place, God. We welcome you in this place, Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
want us to remember that God is always going to be God no matter what happens in the world. And one of the great things about God being God is that He never changes. Who He was at the beginning of time is who He is today, and is who He will be forevermore. So He has always been God. He is God now, and He will be God. But the interesting thing about relationship with Him is that because He's never going to change who He is, He doesn't need anyone's adoration or praise to determine that He's God. Instead, because He's God and we recognize it, we choose to acknowledge that He is God. And so that's why we can get together, as Hebrews chapter 10 said, gathering together, never stopping to gather together and to encourage one another. That's why people can shout and dance. That's why we can weep. That's why we can sit and think and process through not only what God has done, but who God is. And for every person, we have a different response to who He is in our worship. And so some of you may have been sitting down this entire time just processing the awesomeness of God. Some of us have been dancing and praising and standing up and praising God for who He is. But I just always want to remind us on Sunday mornings when we get together, we are pointing back to God, who He is. We're thinking through all the things from this week and saying, You are in fact God. We're thinking through, I struggled, but I made it because You are God. We're thinking through that thing I was praying for at the altar last week showed up on Wednesday because You were God. And we're thinking, I'm still in my Job moment, sitting in the dirt trying to figure out why is all of this happening. And we have a moment of surrender and saying, I can't control it, but I do know that You are God. And so I want you to encourage one another. We've been praising and worshiping God. I want you to turn to somebody and say, hey, you, He is God. You are not, I am not. Let's give Him the glory. Amen.
Hey again, everybody. I sound a little different. I ain't got no tears in my ass, but I'm still thinking about how good He is. Y'all, my name is Jasmine Clark, and I am so excited to serve as the ministry leader for New Spirit Children's Dance Ministry. And I also have the privilege of welcoming everybody to a worship today. If this is your first time worshiping with us, whether you are on East City campus, listening on the radio, or if you have joined us in the room today, we are grateful for your presence and we do not take it lightly. And so we want to acknowledge you. If you are on East City campus, we want you to drop in the chat, it's my first time or I'm new here, drop an emoji with a hand wave, and our online community of greeters and congregation is gonna be there to welcome you and flood you with some love. Everybody find a camera and wave at it, say, hey, East City.
Hey, East City.
We love y'all, we are y'all, we are worshiping with you today. If you are here in the room, okay, we want to acknowledge you as well by asking you to stand. We're not going to ask you to tell us your testimony and where you were when Jesus found you. We just want to lay eyes on you. So go ahead and stand if this is your first time with us. Yes. So many family, y'all. So many new faces in the building. Y'all, welcome to Word Tabernacle Church. Welcome to worship. As you see, this has been a really high spirit-filled service already, and we not even done. So at this time, our greeter should have come by to give you a card. If y'all would fill that out for us and let us know like how we can connect with you, because even though this is your first time, we don't want it to be your last time. So at this time, family, oh, I forgot one thing. Once you fill out your card, if you can take it to the Welcome Center in the lobby, we have a gift for you because we want you to come back. So now at this time, family, go ahead and stand up. Let's love on each other and love on our first time visitors. Welcome to worship.
Tree, branching out towards the sky.
We are family. Y'all find your seats. Y'all know Word Eyes love to talk to each other. Don't worry, we got some time after service for that. I see y'all done walked all the way up to the stadium seats. I know that's right, connected with the family. If you don't see your neighbor sitting next to you right now, wave them back over to you, all right? So y'all, it is Homecoming Sunday. And yeah, give it up for Homecoming. Now, Homecoming Sunday is great, but it also comes after a phenomenal weekend of celebrations. And I know that there is so much going on. I know everybody couldn't make it to everything, but it has been a phenomenal weekend. We start our Homecoming celebrations off with Words Have Honors, where we pause to honor people who have been serving diligently and faithfully throughout the year. And we're so thankful for the fact that people are offering their gifts to the kingdom. And so on Words Have Honors, we had our Words Have Champions who were named this year, who are advocating and supporting the ministry, Miss Naomi Wright, Miss Ida Arrington, and Mr. John Mitchell. And at some point, y'all make sure y'all make it to the back hallway. We now have our wall of champions that are up, and they will be the newest people added to the wall of champions. We also had our Unseen and Unheard Award, the person who's serving without being seen and heard, just behind the scenes, Miss Sheila Ann Knight. And our Servant Servant Award goes to a ministry that serves while others are serving, and that went to our culinary ministry. And they're probably right now cleaning up after breakfast because they are servant servants, right? And then we also want to make sure, because during the Words Have Honors, we just pause to appreciate people. And there were two ministries that I mistakenly forgot to mention during Words Have Honors. And so I want to say hey to y'all right now, all right? The first is our communion service team. If you serve in that ministry, stand up real quick. Communion, they serve us communion every first Sunday. We appreciate the work that y'all do. Thank you so very much. And while they're serving us the body of Christ, we got another group that protects our bodies while they're here, the Stronghold Keepers. There's a few of them in the room, but most of them are stationed throughout the building right now. They do more than open doors. They open doors, and that's nice, but they also make sure we are safe and secure. And so we just want to thank y'all for all that y'all do diligently, you know, and as people say, charge it to my head and not my heart. Amen. Amen. So thank y'all so much. Also, y'all should join that ministry. Amen. Amen. See Mike Hunter for more information. All right. Now, after Word Time Honors, we realized that we do love to party here at Word Tabernacle Church, but I found out that nobody likes to party like Aletha Hudson, who was getting it down at the after affair. All right, y'all, it was a great time. We partied all night. And then after the after affair, we came back for the Walk of Hope, and we wanted to make sure that people understand the resources that we have here at the church for mental health awareness and support. And then after that, we had Word Tab Fest with so many great vendors, food, connecting with each other, connecting to your district care leaders. And then we went home only to come back for the mic. And if you were at the mic, you know that thing was good, right? Everybody standing up on chairs in a good way, Pastor. Don't worry. It was Chastity Searcy. She did it. She stood up on the chair and was getting hyped with the... It was Chastity. All right, and so we had a phenomenal time at the mic, but we also have so many things going on. And if you are interested in being a part of next year's homecoming team that helps plan and give ideas, go to quicklinks.wordtab.net, then click on the homecoming website. It's still there. And the first button you'll see is join a planning team. We would love to get insight from members about things that you want to get plugged into and things that we can do to celebrate our family on homecoming weekend. And of course, today we had our homecoming breakfast and y'all signed up, registered, and it maxed out quickly, all right? And so we're excited about that, but also somebody drove the church and they might not be able to get back home because you lost your keys at breakfast. So if you happen to not know where your keys are, go to the Welcome Center after service. You have to describe them because we don't want you taking somebody else's car. Might want a little upgrade. And so if you lost your keys at breakfast, just go to the Welcome Center and describe the keys to them and they will give it to you if they happen to be yours. All right. But now we're here in service and we worship God and we glorify God. But Homecoming Sunday happens to have become something so unique at Word Tabernacle Church because it's a Sunday where big things happen. And so we have been a church family for 18 years now. But then yeah, shout out to 18 years of glory.
We are a family.
I ain't gonna sing. It didn't work out at the mic when I tried, so I'm not gonna do it now, all right?
So we have had 18 years of glory, but did y'all know or recognize that after COVID, when our family couldn't gather physically together, it was homecoming Sunday when we were able to get back together for the first time, and it was in this room. That was our first time back together after COVID, was on homecoming Sunday. And now this homecoming Sunday, you know, we have shifted our ministry model, and pastor in his great wisdom has helped us understand community clusters and outreach a little bit better. And so this is the first Sunday where our Tarboro campus has come back home. If you're from the Tarboro campus, y'all stand up real quick. Tarboro campus, stand up real quick. And as you see, they're already integrated back into the Rocky Mountain. This is the home base. Everybody's integrated and serving because we are, in fact, family. And so welcome back, Tarboro. Welcome back. And so this is a great Sunday, but we also know that there may be some people who have traveled to come back because it's homecoming, and people may have moved or whatnot. And so we want to see who traveled the furthest to get here today. All right, if you traveled more than 500 miles to get to Word Tabernacle Church today, I don't even know how far 500 miles is. That might be Alaska, I don't know. All right, if you traveled more than 45 miles, I know that's Raleigh, Greenville, more than 45 miles, we have someone over here, more, okay. All right, more than 100 miles, more than 100, oh, okay, we got three still standing. All right, where'd y'all travel from? Oh, whoa, four still standing. All right, where'd you travel from? From Northern Virginia in the house? You was getting here this morning, right? Yeah. All right, and Norfolk, Virginia. Norfolk, Virginia. Kernersville. All right, y'all shout out to people who traveled to get here. And we got one more. Oh, there's somebody. Oh, where'd y'all come from? From Baltimore. Y'all came from Baltimore, as Claire Huxtable would say. For those who get it, right? All right, and the next thing is, we want to see who brought the most people with them. Because I know I talked to Harmony Hunter, and she brought some folks from college, right? So Harmony brought two people with her, all right? Who brought the, invited the most people here today? If y'all, anyone in the room brought more than two people to homecoming Sunday? All right, we got Felicia here, anybody else? All right, how many did you bring with you? We got three over here. How many did you bring with you? 11. Okay. So we, 11 folks in the room, appreciate it. All right, and we also know Jalen is also one who loves to dance. We was dancing at the after fair, Jalen, getting it in. And so y'all, this is a phenomenal time for us to celebrate and get together. And we appreciate all that people have done. And we appreciate the home that has been created as we are, in fact, a true family. And so today after service, this is not the end. We're gonna have a phenomenal word from Pastor. We know it's gonna be good seeds that's gonna be planted. After service, we have another opportunity for us to fellowship. And so when you leave service day, last year, the food trucks are right out front of the door. We don't have it set up that way this year. This time, they are down by the gated area, and there are tables and chairs inside the gates for you to be able to sit and enjoy your food. We have lots of vendors. Please make sure that you support those vendors. It is open to the community. And so if you happen to be watching on East City and you want a little burger, a little rib, a little chicken wing, a little sweet treat, we got some funnel cakes, come on down. And on our Facebook and social media, we have a graphic with all of the food trucks. So you're trying to figure out what you're going to eat. Don't check now. I know some of y'all say, I know what I'm getting my menu together. Don't check now. Wait till after service. All right? And y'all can go down there and enjoy the food trucks. And so we have an announcement video and a Thrive moment, and then we'll have our worship team come back up and to sing some more worship, and then we'll get into the preach word. Y'all, we are so glad that we're here because it is homecoming Sunday.
Hello. These are just a few of the things going on through ministry at Word Tabernacle Church. You can go to quicklinks.wordtab.net at any time to review these announcements, check out our monthly newsletter, and to see other ways to get engaged. Third Wednesdays at Word Tabernacle Church is our first generation Wednesdays. That means on October 18th, we will have a special session from 10:30 to 11:30 that informs and empowers our first generation, those who are 70 years old or up. Right after that, we will have Wednesday in the Word in the chapel at 12 o'clock to 12:45. And while these are specifically geared toward our first generation ministries, everyone is invited to come if it fits for you. After that, we will have a special fellowship lunch. So please, if you're part of the first generation, come out on Wednesday, October 18th for this great time of development, encouragement, and fellowship. The My Journey Through Grief Group is designed to help navigate the hills and the valleys as you adjust to a new way of life without your loved ones. This group is open to anyone in the community. The group will meet monthly on third Saturday beginning at 10 a.m. in room 450 at the Impact Center. If you would like additional information, please contact Lillian Brown at lillian.brown@wordtab.net. Next Gen Connect Weekend is a three-day overnight retreat right here at the Impact Center for students in 4th through 13th grades. It is on Thursday, November 9th at 6 p.m. through Saturday, November 11th at 2 p.m. Students will have an amazing time connecting with each other through great activities including basketball, youth games, and our Glow Night Party. We will also go out into the community to engage and serve. The entire retreat is $75 per student. We welcome adults to sponsor students, volunteer, or even help by providing meals and snacks. You can go to nextgen.wordtab.net for more information and to register or to register through the Ministry One app. Do you need a ride to church or to Bible study? Call 252-446-2158 and leave a voicemail with our transportation ministry. We also need drivers for weekly services and special trips. So if you have your general driver's license or a CDL, this will be a great place for you to serve. Contact Gerald Branch at gerald.branch@wordtab.net. We believe that giving and offering is a part of our worship experience. And we believe that God provides for us and we provide for His kingdom work here on earth. We don't pass the offering plate here at Word Tabernacle Church, but you can give through one of our many methods. You can mail in, drop off, you can use Cash App, $WordTab, you can give through our Ministry One app, or you can go to wordtab.net/giving. God provides for us and we provide for His work. We worship through our giving. These are just a few of the things happening here at Word Tabernacle Church. Don't miss out on anything by staying connected through our Ministry One app, going to quicklinks.wordtab.net and checking out our newsletter, or checking out our church calendar at wordtab.net. But this is Sunday morning, and we have come and gathered to make sure we worship God and glorify Him. And so stand to your feet, because this is a time for us to worship in freedom, in spirit, and in truth. We invite you to raise your hands, to clap, to shout hallelujah.
Our communities are in need of great leaders. Most of the time, those leaders come from our local churches. And I'm here today to lift up and to honor those during this month that have been leaders as pastors in our community. This is October, National Pastors Appreciation Month. And I'm asking you, to be good and encouraging and lifting of your local pastor. They have been in the trenches, had to pastor through some difficult and some dark times, especially as we've come out of a season of something we've never seen before, but they hung in there. So during October, I want you to encourage your leader, encourage your pastor, and lift him up during National Pastors Appreciation Month. During this month, I ask that you would send them a note, send them an email, get them a card, encourage them in any way. Hey, give them a tangible gift. Encourage them to keep on pushing on during this season. The Bible reminds us regularly that we ought to give homage to those who serve over us or have rule over us. And we need to especially honor those that preach and teach the Word of God. I'm asking all of you that hear this, see this, that you would encourage your pastor during October. Whatever you do, make sure that you show honor for National Pastors Appreciation Month. Thank you so much.
worship. East City Campus, we're grateful that you're worshiping with us. I got a little emotional today just looking at all y'all in this room, and I'm not gonna get on my soapbox and share my testimony, but God has been good. God has been good. Y'all making us spend money we hadn't planned on spending. They leaned over to me and said, we don't have no parking spaces, Pastor. And we have people trying to get on the campus and they parking across the street. And so we're gonna have to tear up some grass and put some asphalt down and add some parks. Hadn't planned on doing that. Now you remember that clap when it's offering time, okay? Remember that. I'm gonna pray and we're gonna look at the word for a moment, but I really am grateful for everyone and your work and your efforts and your ministry and your giving and all that you're doing. It is really, really overwhelming. I mean, just look around yourself for a minute. Look around yourself. And it's phenomenal. And when I came here 18 years ago, a local pastor visited me at our building at 820 Nashville Road, and he told me that we didn't need another church in Rocky Mount. And they would have ministers' alliance meetings that they wouldn't invite me to because my church was so small. And that was 18 years and 3,000 people ago. And we give God all the glory and all the praise and all the honor. It all belongs to Him. And so I'm not going to preach real long today. I'll go ahead, touch somebody on their shoulder or grab their hand. Let's pray together. If you're on East City campus, let us know where you're worshiping from. Let's get ready to worship together. Lord, bless my neighbor that I'm touching right now. I thank you for their witness in this place. I thank you for their worship in this place. I pray now, God, that collectively as a church, you would enable us to receive the word that you're about to give us. Would you bless everything concerning my neighbor right now? Would you bless every person on the East City campus? And pray now, God, that even though I have studied, we know it means nothing without your spirit. And even though I have prepared, it is pointless without your power and without your presence. And although our collective hearts are willing, only you can make us able. So now, would you give us now, God, information for our heads because we're thinking people. Information for our heads because we are thinking people. Inspiration for our hearts because we are feeling people. And implementation for our hands that it might be said we are doing people. Heal and deliver according to that word and save for your name's sake. Speak, Lord. We're listening. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Would you remain standing and turn to Genesis chapter 12, verse 10. I'm in a series of sermons called All In. Everybody shout All In. And today I want to lift up, beginning at verse 10 down to verse 20. It's going to be on the screen for you, and so I want us to read it all together in one voice. Genesis chapter 12, beginning at verse number 10. Let's begin. Let's read together. Now there was a famine in the land, and Abram went down to Egypt to dwell there, for the famine was severe in the land. And it came to pass, when he was close to entering Egypt, that he said to Sarai, his wife, "Indeed, I know that you are a woman of beautiful countenance. Therefore, it will happen when the Egyptians see you that they will say, 'This is his wife,' and they will kill me, but they will let you live. Please say you are my sister, that it may be well with me for your sake, and that I may live because of you. So it was when Abram came into Egypt that the Egyptians saw the woman, that she was very beautiful. The princes of Pharaoh also saw her and commended her to Pharaoh. And the woman was taken to Pharaoh's house. He treated Abram well for her sake. He had sheep, oxen, male donkeys, male and female servants, female donkeys, and camels. But the Lord plagued Pharaoh and his house with great plagues because of Sarai, Abram's wife. And Pharaoh called Abram and said, "What is this you have done to me? Why did you not tell me that she was your wife? Why did you say she is my sister? I might have taken her as my wife. Now therefore, here is your wife. Take her and go your way." So Pharaoh commanded his men concerning him, and they sent him away with his wife and all that he had. Amen. Look at somebody before you take your seat. Look at them. Tell them, friend, this failure will not be final. Amen. Amen. You can have your seat in the presence of God. I want to tag this text, this failure will not be final. With all of this internet television stuff, you know, I grew up with an antenna on top of the TV. I grew up having to wiggle it towards the window. But with this internet television now, sometimes like those old kung fu movies, the activity and the audio don't sync. And so, you know, you'll be watching a show and, you know, and they'll say whatever they say, you know, go do it that way. And then 4 seconds later, and I got to thinking about life, that sometimes what I say and what I do don't sync. That there are times when the audio and the video of my life don't match up. That there are moments in my life where God tells me to do something, but my activity around what God has told me to do does not match up. Anybody at church have had moments where God has told you to do one thing, but your activity had you doing something? If we were to be honest, all of us in this space have had moments in my life when my life is just out of sync. It doesn't mean that I'm not saved. It doesn't mean I don't love God. If it means anything at all, it means I am human. And when I am human, there's going to be moments in my life where my faith falters. Tell somebody, sometimes your faith falters. Moments in my life when I fail. Moments in my life when I get it wrong. I want to encourage everybody in this room that just because I have a moment of failure does not mean God is going to allow that failure to be the final. As a matter of fact, before I even unpack this text, is there anybody other than James Galliard in church or on the East City campus that can look back over your life and say, man, I blew it a time or two, but God was faithful enough to me to not allow the time I falter to let it destroy me? There is this dichotomy. Let me just set this up, y'all. There is this dichotomy of faith that exists not only in the text, but in our lives. Here's the dichotomy of faith, Max. The dichotomy of faith is that I seem to be better at trusting God on eternal things than I do temporal things. In a moment, you're gonna have an opportunity to get saved, join the church. It's going to be your way of saying, I trust God for heaven. I trust God for salvation. I trust God for forgiveness. I trust God for victory. I trust God for the promise of heaven. But then after I get saved, life happens. And when life happens, I can't just trust God for heaven. I got to learn to trust God for earth. And this is the moment, Yolanda, where my faith falters. Because I gotta be able to trust God to supply my daily needs. I gotta be able to trust God to carry my burdens. I gotta be able to trust God to rejoice in the face of my trials. I gotta know how to trust God to empower me to accomplish what He's calling me to do. I gotta learn how to trust God in the valleys and the lows of my life. And in our text, I love this. The father of the faith, Abram, starts off strong. God says, get out of your land, leave your stuff. And he starts out strong and does exactly what God calls him to do. And then he starts to get his faith tested and tried. Because he gets to the land, and Canaanites are in the land. It's almost like having, Cynthia, a wealthy friend who's like, I want you to go down to Florida. And when you get to the Florida Keys, I'm going to send you to an address. And that house, million-dollar house on the waterfront, I'm giving it to your descendants. And you pack up your car. And pack up your family, drive down to Florida, only to find another family is living in the house. This is the situation that Abram is dealing with. And at that moment, his faith now is being tested. And in the midst of his faith being tested, the Bible says the father of the faith loses faith. He doesn't stay in Canaan. The text says he goes to Egypt. And we have to understand that scripturally, Egypt is not just a geographical destination. The statement about Egypt is also a spiritual statement. It is not just him going down away from Canaan. It is him leaving God. And today, I want to just lift up this failure of Abram. That we can see that when you and I have moments of failing, it does not have to be final. And there are people in this room that you are living in your failed moment right now. The marriage could be failing. The business could be failing. The ministry could be failing. The vision could be failing. And at this moment, this is what I want you to hear. If you don't hear anything else, it does not have to be final. I want you to get that thing in your spirit. But I want to learn from Father Abram what he went through. There are four things I want to try to lift up if I can. The first thing, y'all, I want you to see in this text is that there is an imposed dilemma. Everybody say a dilemma. Verse number 10, it says there was a famine. Everybody say a famine. There was a famine in the land. And so he gets to where God calls him to, Canaan, and there's a famine there. Here's the problem, y'all. The problem is the man of faith does not trust God to let him live through the famine. And I want to park here for a moment because sometimes famines don't come because something is wrong. Let me help y'all get there. He's worried about something that could never happen. Y'all didn't catch it. Let me tell you what can't happen. He can't die of starvation. The reason he can't die of starvation is because God has made him a promise that has not yet been fulfilled.
And when God makes you a promise, you are immortal until that promise comes to pass. And so you better stop talking about the devil trying to kill me. The devil can't kill you. The devil can't harm you. God will keep, oh, I'm sorry, y'all. I gotta preach myself happy. God will keep you alive until he gets done doing whatever God wants to do in your life. Tell your neighbor, I'm gonna be here till God get done. He gets to the land, it's bad enough that there are Canaanites there, but on top of that, there is famine in the land. He begins to fear that he will die of starvation. So because he fears that he dies of starvation, he does not consult with God. I hope y'all paying attention for the series. Everywhere else he been, he builds an altar. This is what he forgot to realize, John. What he didn't realize was the famine was imposed deliberately by God to create a dilemma so that he could have his faith tested. So I want to help somebody. Sometimes God will let you go through what you go through, not because you're going to die in it, but because he's trying to see, do you really have the faith that you said you had? I don't know who I'm talking to, but sometimes God will allow there to be sickness. God will allow folk to leave you. He will allow folk to betray you. He will allow folk to abandon you, just so you can see, do you really have faith? See, it's God is setting him up. It's an imposed dilemma. Let me stop for a moment, y'all. See, everything ain't Satan's fault. I had to say it that way for emphasis. It's not always what Satan has done. Sometimes God is looking up from glory, saying, you claim to be all that in me. You've done real good at worshiping and clapping with money in your pocket. You've done real good at giving me glory and praise when you got a family full of friends and a house full of friends. In fact, you do real well saying I'm all that as long as you got a good paying job. Let me just see here for a moment that when you get sick, when folk walk out on you, let me see them what you really made out of. Do I have anybody in church that loves God enough that no matter what state I find myself, I'm going to learn to give God glory in that place? Tell somebody, this could be an imposed dilemma. He gets to Canaan. There's a famine in the land, Crystal. And he doesn't realize the only reason there's a famine in the land is because I'm trying to show you, you don't really have the faith yet that you need to have in order for me to do what I'm trying to do. And so, he gets to the land, and Trishonda, there's a famine there that's been imposed by God. I'm gonna move on, but I want somebody to get this in your spirit because you're in the room, you're on East City campus, and you're living this thing out. You think that I'm going through what I'm going through, it must mean I'm not being favored by God. It must mean that God doesn't love me. It must mean that God is not for me. No, it means exactly the opposite. It means that God recognizes, oh God, this is so good if we can get this thing in our spirit. God recognizes that all of his blessings cannot come easy. Because if all of the blessings come easy, then I'll start having a relationship with him and worshiping him just because of what I can get from him. But when the blessings don't come easy, what they do is they build your character. They build your faith muscle. They build your wisdom. I wish I had. See, one of our problems, y'all, and I'm not trying to wish bad on our young people, because I want them to live in the fullness of everything God wants them to do. But we as parents sometimes have to be careful that we don't just hand them everything and make it easy. Because if everything just gets given to you, the moment, if you don't have to work for it and sweat for it and pray for it, if you see, when you got to trust God for some stuff, you learn. I wish I had a handful of people that could look back over your life and say, I got a few things, but let me tell you, I had to pray my way through. I had to worship my way through. I had to cry my way through. I had to scream my way through. I had to be frustrated in this thing. Is there anybody in church that knows it did not come easy? You're gonna have some sleepless nights. You're gonna have some disappointing moments. And what I don't wanna do is raise a bunch of cotton candy Christians. We don't want Christians around here. We don't want wordites who only can thrive when they got a lollipop in their mouth. That can only thrive when everything is good in their life. We want to raise up people that know how to suffer, that know how to trust, that know how to surrender. So when the bottom falls out, I ain't going nowhere. I'm going to stick right here. Just parenthetically, you know it, but you need to be reminded. You don't know where a person stands with you until they are required to stand with you when they don't agree with you or when they see you struggling. Early days of our church, I said, God, we need some hard days. We need some days of disagreeing. We need some days of disapproving. We need some days of doubting. Why? We need them because you don't really know where folk are until they still get to choose to be with you when they disagree with you, doubt you, or are disappointed with you. I'm sorry, I'm trying to move on. I'm not gonna be much longer. It's homecoming Sunday. Y'all give me a little grace. He gets to Canaan. And there's a famine in the land imposed by God to test his faith. Nowhere in these verses do we see that he prays. Nowhere in these verses do we see that he consults God. Nowhere in these verses do we see that he worships. Nowhere in this text do we see that he exhibits any kind of faith at all. The father of faith is having a moment of faltering faith. If the father of faith loses faith sometimes, then you need to give your neighbor some space and some grace. We got to stop expecting that I'm always gonna be on top of my game. I can't expect from other believers that I'm always gonna feel like a smile on my face. I gotta stop expecting from people that I won't have some moments of my humanity. In this moment of humanity, he gets scared and he packs his family and voluntarily goes to Egypt. He voluntarily leaves Canaan and goes to the world. He leaves church and goes to the world. Because he didn't like what he was seeing in church, he packs up and he goes to Egypt by the Nile. Egypt, where the running waters of the Nile will keep things fertile. To Egypt by the Nile, where there's a guarantee that there'll never be a concern for a famine. And he gets there, and before they go in good, Mother Edge, he looks at his wife. Now, this woman is like 65 years old. The Bible says she's so fine that he says, they will kill me to have you. Now, I don't care what y'all say, that's a fine woman right there. So what he does is he inserts a deceit. Baby, we need to agree that I'm gonna tell them you're my sister because you so fine, they will move you from being a wife to being a widow. It won't be good for you and it won't be good for me. So what he does is, for some reason, this is gonna hit you in between the eyes, he thinks I need to lie to promote the work of the Lord. I want to encourage us, be careful what you give birth to. Be careful what we are communicating. Because at the end of the day, y'all, the problem is, and I've seen this with folk, they make up a lie and then start believing the lie they made up. So Abram births it, behaves like it, and then believes it. So just like he says, I'm almost there, y'all. Just like he says, the princess of Pharaoh look around and like, think Pharaoh might want to meet her. And so they take Sarai, make her a part of Pharaoh's harem. I want to deliberately take my time with this because I'm talking about the father of the faith. I want you to see how flawed godly people can be. Here's his story. Pharaoh is so pleased with having the finest woman on earth in his harem that he begins paying Abram for her being in the harem. He's now in Egypt with camels, servants, oxen, and you have to understand, donkeys. And I want you to, let me show y'all something in the scriptures real quick. Let me show you something in the scriptures real quick. In verse 16, he treated Abram well for her sake. Sheep, oxen, male donkeys, now watch this, male and female servants. And then he specifies female donkeys and camels. You would wonder, why do I need to know if they're male or female? The reason I need to know is because their value is determined by their gender. Female donkeys were more stable and more trustworthy to ride. So when it says he got female donkeys and then female camels, camels had just become domesticated, which means it is the equivalent of having a Lexus, a Ferrari, and a Beamer in the Nile. So while his wife is in the harem, he's shot calling. I want you to see this. What man do you know will compromise his wife just so he could have stuff? And yet, this is our father of faith. I'm gonna keep saying it until you get it. Everyone has the ability to have their faith falter. So he lives a lie, and now God is like, hold up, bro. I didn't send you to Egypt. So now God has a dilemma. The dilemma God has is, I can't grab you by the collar and pull you back to Canaan. Because God doesn't make us do anything. So God is not going to bother him there and just say, you got to come on back. You're being disobedient. What God will do, since he won't touch you, he'll touch something that's touching you. See, God don't have to pull you up. He don't have to make you not sit next to somebody. He could just make them stink. You could be sitting there like, now watch what happens. I want you to get what, I'm almost done. Y'all, I want you to get what happens. God sends a plagues on the house of Pharaoh. Immediately, Pharaoh is like, something wrong. The question becomes, how does he know it was Sarah? Because everybody was plagued in the house except her. So Pharaoh looks around and says, the problem is Abram and Sarah. And then he says, look, man, I need you to get your wife, get your stuff, and get out of here. Let me help y'all understand what God does. He will indirectly discipline me. See, when I won't listen to him, he'll talk to somebody that'll make me listen to them. And so because Abram was not talking to God, he knew that Abram was listening to the Pharaoh. So since he was listening to the Pharaoh, God plagues Pharaoh and then has Pharaoh speak to Abram. Isn't it funny how God can use ungodly people to get... I'm almost done, y'all. I hadn't planned. I'm not trying to make y'all shout today. I just need y'all to get this lesson. The father of the faith has spiraled so out of control that he got kicked out of the world by the world. Pharaoh says, man, all this stuff I got going on because of you. You got to get out. Now, this is less about my faith faltering and more about how good God is. Let me show you how good God is. God is so good that he initiates a deliverance for Abram in his disobedience. Y'all missed it. Y'all missed it. Let me help y'all understand how good God is. God is so good that he finds a way not only for Abram and Sarah to leave, but he finds a way for them to live. Y'all still missed it. Y'all, let me read it to y'all. I'm done. I really am. He says, what have you done? Why'd you didn't tell me she was your wife? Why do you say she is my sister? I might have taken her as my wife. Therefore, here is your wife. Take her and go your way. Pharaoh commanded his men, and they sent him away with his wife and all they had. Let me show you how good God is. God is so good that even in my disobedience, he knows how to find a way. I wish I had a handful of people. He goes to Canaan with nothing. He's disobedient in Canaan, goes to Egypt, gets to Egypt, and he's given oxen and camels, servants. Y'all ain't ready. Y'all ain't ready. Let me tell you why I know he took the servants too. The reason I know he took the servants too, because of like around chapter 16, he gets frustrated, thinking that he can't have a child. And the Bible says he takes his handmaiden, Egyptian handmaiden, Hagar. Well, where did Hagar come from? He was able to take her when he went to Egypt. God is so good that he'll let me leave and live and have more in my disobedience. Oh, God. Y'all, I'm done. Is there anybody in church that can thank God that you survived your own disobedience? Is there anybody in church that can praise God because I survived my own lie? Is there anybody? Come on, y'all, this is shouting time. When I look back over my life, I want to throw my head back and say, God, I thank you for letting me live. Put your hand and say, God, I thank you for letting me live. New mercy I see day by day. Great is your faithfulness. Tell two people he didn't have to do it, but he let me live. In my disobedience, he let me live. When things didn't go my way, he let me live. When I messed up and did dumb, he let me live. Is there anybody here that can thank God for letting you live? All the times I got drunk, he let me live. All the time I slept around, he let me live. All the times I smoked a blunt, he let me live. All the times I was drinking and driving, he let me live. All the overeating, and he let me live. All the backstabbing, and he let me live. This failure is not final. This failure is not final. I'm almost done. He didn't just let him live. He didn't just let him live, y'all. He put it on Pharaoh's heart. See, Pharaoh didn't let him live because of him. Pharaoh didn't care nothing about Abram. Pharaoh let him live because he was scared of God. Because he thinking, I don't know who this man is, but if he got that kind of pull with God, I want him out of my situation. And I don't know who I'm preaching to, but sometimes God has favored you in front of people, not because people cared anything about you, but they were fearful of the God you serve. No praying, and he lets him live. No worship, and he lets him live. No altars being built, and he lets him live. He fails his marriage, and he fails his ministry, and God helps him recover both. I can't imagine this kind of favor. Pharaoh says, get this woman, this wife of yours, and get out. I don't know who I'm saying this to. Whatever you are dealing with in your marriage, it is not as bad as this. And if they could walk away holding hands, then what you're going through doesn't have to be final. If the man who is the father of the faith can falter and God help him recover, God can do the same for you. It does not have to be final. It does not have to be final. So I want to pray. I'm sorry I didn't have a whole lot of shouting material today. This is about the goodness and faithfulness of God. The songwriter says he didn't have to let me live. He didn't have to let me live. I want to do two things on this homecoming Sunday. The first thing I want to do, I don't want anyone moving. I don't want any vocalists right now. I don't want any care leaders or altar counselors moving. I want everybody just listening to me. The first thing that I want to do is I want to be fully convinced, and I want you fully convinced of your salvation. And so in a moment, I'm going to ask you to grab whatever you brought to church today. I want you to come to me. I want you to walk down the aisle in just a moment. Don't move yet, but in a moment, I want you to do that. On the East City campus, I want you to get ready to click a link. Here's the second thing. And this is really where the Lord has my heart right now. You're here. You're on the East City campus. And you have messed up. What God was saying do and what you were doing were not in sync. But yet, God has let you live. He has let you make it. Even in your disobedience, he's let you do it. This is what I want you to do. This is what, in a moment, this is what's going to happen. You're already saved, but I've been out of sync. Let me help you for a moment. If I'm saved, but I'm not active in a church, then you like that kung fu movie. Because what God is saying and what you are doing are not the same. Because he don't never say get saved and then don't be a part of a church. He don't never say that. So today I have a chance to line up my life with my words. It is not the people in the church who faith falters that's the hypocrite. Because even the greatest man of faith had a moment of faltering faith. It does not make him a hypocrite. It makes him human. And there are people that you have watched people in church life not line up. And your response is, I don't want to be a part of the church for that reason. That is not the hypocrisy. The hypocrisy is not, I'm in church and I'm having a faltering faith moment. The hypocrisy is your claim of salvation and not being in church. My God, that's the hypocrisy. Because if you were to be honest, oh, Mr. and Mrs. Judge, you've had moments when your faith faltered. Even Abram. So the second group of people I'm talking to, you've been saved, you've been a part of a church, but you left church for whatever reason. And today, in a moment, I want you to come back to church. Third group of people I'm talking to are people that are saved, but you're just not really, you didn't get hurt by the church. You just don't have a lot of value in it up until this point. But you're starting to recognize, you know what? I need to be around people of faith. People who trust God, people who worship, people that can give counsel, people that I can support in my ministry and they can support in my ministry, people that have gifts that can be lent to me and my gift can be lent to them. I'm a body. People who realize I'm not just a head. Look at the person next to you for a moment. Is their head on their shoulders? Because they recognize that if God is going to use me, I can't be disjointed. I got to be connected to something.
Help us, Pastor, help us.
A And so the third group of people I'm talking to that you say, but you're not really connected with anything. And today I want to invite you to connect. And here's the last group of people I'm talking to. For the first time in the history of our church, we get to do church in a community that is growing. For many years, there was a net migration with people leaving this community. Now people are moving into this community. Homes are being built here. They're being built in Zebulun, and they're being built in Spring Hope. They're being built in various places. So people are relocating here. They're moving in this community. And when they get here, they need a church. We see lots of people coming from subdivisions in Zebulun and Roseville and Knightdale and Wendell and Greenville and Spring Hope and Tarboro and Wilson. So the final call is, I'm one of those people, Pastor. I've relocated here. Now I need a church in my community. And really the fifth group of people are people on our East City campus. We are figuring out digital discipleship for you. We're figuring it out for you. And so you may say, look, I live in Virginia, I live in Northern Virginia, I live in Baltimore, but I want to be an East City Campus member of Word. I'm going to do my ministry in my local community, but I'm going to log on every Sunday morning at 9 o'clock and I'm going to worship in my living room, I'm going to worship in my community center. We want to have you a part of our ministry. And so if any of that is speaking to what's going on in your life, this is what I want you to do. I want you to gather whatever you brought to church today, and I want you to begin walking down these aisles. Altar counselors, y'all can come. Music, y'all can come. Come on, this is your moment. I need a church home. I want a relationship with Jesus. Come on, we're up in the stadium seating. Come on, we're going to wait for you wherever you are in the room. Come on, wherever you are in the room, we're waiting for you to come. I know you're in the room. I know you're on East City campus, so we're going to wait for you. I want to just announce who you are. I want to celebrate you. Come on, I want to celebrate you. Come on, family. Come on, family. Tell me your name. What's the first name? Sharon, y'all, this is Sister Sharon, y'all. I want you to go ahead and go with Lisa, okay? Great decision. Hey, man, tell me your name. Maurice, come on, look at the camera. I want everybody to see. This is Brother Maurice. Come on, man, celebrate you. Come on, who's going to take him? You take him? Tell me your name. Jonathan, come on, look at the camera. Named after your daddy. Come on here. Come on, it's a great decision. You want to take him, Tristan? Go ahead with Tristan. Hey, baby, come on here. Tell me who you are. What is it? Porshika? Porshika, y'all. This is Sister Porshika. How are you, baby? You okay? It's a great decision. I want you to go ahead and go with her, okay? Come on. Bless you, family. Hey, my brother. Tell me your name, man. Shelton. And who are you? Anna? Y'all, this is Shelton and Anna. Welcome to the family. Great to have y'all. I want you to go ahead and go with Brother Kirby right behind you, all right? Hey, baby. How are you? Good. Tell me your name. Say it again. Quay Sandra. You live here in Rocky Mountain? Wonderful. I'm so glad you're here. Who's going to take her? Peggy, you coming back home, baby? Peggy, coming back home. I'm so glad. Tell me your name.
Peyton.
Y'all, this is Peyton. Oh, this is, they're together? I'm so sorry. Cool, keep your family together. Y'all can go ahead and sing the song, y'all. Sing the song. Hey, how are you? Tell me your name. I'm sorry. Iris, so good to meet you. This is Sister Iris. Where? From Baltimore. Sister Iris from Baltimore. Come on, would you go ahead and go at the rear? Hey, darling, how are you? Rosita Davis. Oh, so good to have you. This is Miss Gwen. She's going to take good care of you, all right? Welcome to our family. I'll do it. Where are you from? I'm glad. I'm glad. I'm grateful. Go ahead with Miss Gwen. Okay, I'm sorry. Tell me your name. Tony. Y'all, this is Tony. Can we celebrate Tony? Tell me your name. Kinston. This is Kinston. Come on, here. What? You and him? All right. Hey, man. Tell me your name, brother. Rodney. This is Brother Rodney, family. Come on. I want you to go ahead and go with him. Hey, you tell me your name. What is it? Kaz. Charles Jr. Okay, all right. Good to have you. Come on. You got it? Are you going to go? Hey, tell me your name. Darion. Come on, this is Brother Darion. Turn around so we can see you. Come on here. Come on. We want you to come. We want you to come. Come on. Okay. You're already a member, but you're just coming back to reconnect. Okay. So I still want you to go with Brenda so we can make sure we have all your stuff in order, all right? Come on, celebrate God. Come on. Come on, East City Campus, we're waiting on you. It's not too late for you to come, wherever you are. Today. On third Sundays, we minister in Caledonia State Prison. There have been 6 salvation decisions today. Caledonia State Prison. Hey, baby. Okay, tell me your name. Carmen, y'all. This is Carmen, all right? Come on, let's celebrate her. You want to take her?
All right. Be upon you and a thousand.
It's not too late for you to come. I want you to come. It's going to be the best decision you can make. You need a church home where you need to connect. So if you're a little nervous, you know, sometimes first-time visitors wind up joining our church and they're like, I can't do that because that's so crazy. Who visits a church for the first time and then joins? But if you know God is calling you here, don't wait till next Sunday. Don't wait till next month. Go ahead and respond to God right now. When I wait for you to come, I know you're in the wrong. While we're in the room, we have a children's church ministry, 2 salvation decisions this morning in children's church. Come on, family, come on.
The children, may his presence go before you and behind you.
Come on, family, that's right. Come on, family.
All around you.
I need an altar counselor. Come on.
Hey, darling. He is with you.
Good, tell me your name. I'm sorry. Darlene Boomer. The children are coming. Tell me your name.
And you're going.
Malia and what's your name? Kobe. Malia and Kobe. This is good. You're going to go with them, Chastity? I want you to go with Chastity, all right? Come on. Hey. Tell me your name. Yolanda Webb. We are so good to have you. Thank you. Welcome. 4 boys. Everybody coming. They're in the children's church. That's awesome. You're going to take Keisha. Go with Keisha. Welcome. Can we celebrate Andrea, y'all? Come on. Hey. Tell me your name.
Olivia.
Y'all, this is Sister Olivia. Come on, let's celebrate her. I want you to go with Lisa. Come on, it's not too late. You can come on, come on. Hey, darling, tell me your name. Cheryl. This is Sister Cheryl. I want you to go with Lisa, all right? Great decision. I'm celebrating you.
Generations. Your family.
All right, we have a decision from Coretta in Rocky Mount and Shania in Chicago. Hi in Chicago. Come on, it's not too late for you to come. I want to pray over us and pray over our fellowship in a minute.
You're coming.
It's not too late.
Rejoice, he is for you.
Somebody give me a count from the back. I don't want to pray till I have that.
We agree with you, God.
On the East City Campus, we'll wait for you. Go to quicklinks.wordtab.net. Facebook, you're on our website, you're on YouTube, on Twitter, whatever platform you're on, you can make the decision. Quicklinks.wordtab.net.
Your word is good, and we sing.
I want to pray over the house. Y'all, it's been a wonderful weekend, has it not? God is moving in such a wonderful way. We have a decision from Atlanta, Georgia. Constance, we see you. We got somebody coming. That's right. Come on, brother. Come on. It's not too late.
Generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor
we'll wait
be
for you.
Upon you and a thousand
on, we'll wait for you.
Generations and your family. Children and their children.
up in the stadium seating. I know this, the walk is long, but we'll wait for you.
Upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children.
But we're going to pray. I need to count before I pray.
And their children, may his favor be upon you.
And y'all lift up a song that I want to just have a congregational worship song, something we all know. Whatever y'all want to lift up.
His presence go before you, and behind you, and beside you, all around you, and within you.
We just waiting to see what the Lord has done. I don't want to pray for us until we get all the counts in. Because this is somebody's son, somebody's daughter. This is somebody's family member. 27 decisions. And so, celebrate God. Come on, y'all, let's pray. Come on, stand up all over this room. I want us to worship that. I want us to sing one song together. I want something we all know, something that I want every voice in the church, every voice on East City campus. We all know that. All over the room, put your hand on their shoulder. I want to dismiss and thank you for your giving as you leave or as you give digitally. I want to ask your patience. We have a bit of a parking problem. It's going to take a minute for us to be able to move vehicles. We're really crowded out there. Some of us need to leave right away, but others will be here for the food trucks. I hope we'll all hang out. Let's support the food trucks. Let's fellowship together. Let's finish homecoming weekend really, really strong. Amen. And so if you're parked out back, we're going to have to navigate you because it's a little congested out there, but we'll figure it out, all right? It's a good problem, y'all. All our problems are good problems. All of our problems are good ones. Lord, thank you for what you're doing. It's a little overwhelming, God. It's a little mind-boggling. And God, today we witness you saving in so many places. Today, God, you save people on East City. You save people in this room. You save people in the children's church. You save people in the prison. You are so active. And so, God, we want to thank you for everything that you're doing in our lives. God, I want to pray a prayer of encouragement over every person in this room, over every person on the East City campus, that when they have their moments of their faith faltering, let them be convinced that it doesn't have to be final. I'm praying, God, for that marriage that's really struggling, and they think they can't recover. They think they can't make it. But God, we have witnessed a man make a really poor decision in his marriage, and yet you were able to restore. I pray for restoration in our relationships in the name of the Lord. God, I'm praying for people that are back in the room, but they know they're ready to make that decision like Peggy did to come back home. I pray, God, that today they would be clear that they can always come back home. And I pray, God, that we see an ongoing and an active return of every person who needs to return. God, I want to pray for our mission and our ministry, the moments that we've had setbacks because what you said and what I was doing was not lining up. God, thank you for letting me live through my seasons of disobedience. Thank you for letting me get out of some stuff I got me into. Lord, thank you for saving me from me. And God, as we prepare to leave church today, we know we never leave your presence. You said you're always with us until the end of our days. And so I pray this priestly blessing upon every individual and every household. May the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace and his grace and his favor for you and your household for now and forever. Bless our food and the food trucks. Bless our fellowship. Bless our exit offering as we give, whether through the envelopes or digitally. Bless the prayer requests that will be given and left in the boxes. And bless my neighbor as we leave. In Jesus' name. And God's people together said, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And amen. Come on, clap your hands. Come on, y'all. Let's lift up a worship in this room. As we leave, come on, let's worship the Lord as we leave. Have a little pulse worship. God's been so good. He's been so good.